November gale killed a plumber in Slough. A lady on her way to demonstrate the boning of a shoulder of lamb to the Bromyard Women's Institute. An aromatherapist from Wakefield. And Reginald Iolanthe Perrin. More than 20 years ago, in a church not far from here, a memorial service was held for Reggie Perrin.
And he was present. In the congregation. In disguise. Having faked his suicide by leaving his clothes on the beach.
This time, this good man has gone for good. The manner of his death may seem to those who knew him to be a curiously appropriate full stop at the end of the bizarre sentence that was his life. He was struck by a falling billboard advertising the Royal and General Accident Insurance Company.
Ironically,
that was the company with which he himself was insured. God moves in a mysterious way.
Absolutely right. I didn't get where I am today without knowing that God moves in a mysterious way.
Thank you so much for coming.
Sir Joe. You're inviting anybody back to the house? You know, sausage rolls, tea, coffee, something stronger for those who like it?
No.
Some of them have come a long way.
Yes.
David and Prue Harris-Jones have come all the way from West Wales.
Well, that's very kind of them. Now they can go all the way back to West Wales.
Well, bad form, wouldn't you say?
Absolutely.
What?
Reggie loved bad form. I'm doing it in his honour. In his memory.
Ah, with you. Well done, that woman. Bad form, good show.
Dear Major Anderson, I am writing in connection with the last will and testament of your brother-in-law, Reginald Iolanthe Perrin. If you will present yourself at our offices at 11:30 a.m. on the 23rd inst, you may hear something to your advantage. Yours sincerely, Geraldine Hackstraw, senior partner, Hackstraw, Lovelace and Venison, solicitors.
Jimmy!
Hello, Tom. What brings you to this neck of the woods? Not your usual stomping ground, I'd have thought.
Well, the same as you, of course.
What?
The letter. Reggie's will.
Ah! By Jove, Tom, no flies on you.
What?
Well, I see you think, what's he doing here? You see me twig straight away. There's Jimmy. He's got a letter from the solicitors too. Brains, Tom. I went AWOL the day they were dished out. You didn't. Simple as that.
Well, thank you, Jimmy.
How's the homemade wine?
Going along very much as ever.
Oh, dear. Sorry to hear that. Can't help wondering, can you? Not being greedy, but something to your advantage. Can't help wondering.
It said may learn something to your advantage. I can't help thinking Reggie may have one last trick up his sleeve. Not that it bothers me. I'm not a money person.
Nice of him to remember the family, that.
Well, he would. He was a family person.
Tom! Jimmy!
CJ.
So you've had the letter too? You see? Brains on all sides.
We're a bit early. Fancy a quick drink?
11:03 hours, a bit early for me. They'll hardly be open. Besides, it might look bad if we turn up in mid-morning stinking of drink. Yes, please, what a good idea.
Hello, Mummy.
Oh, hello, Linda, darling.
Oh. I thought I was too early.
You are. I was even more too early. I nearly didn't come in. I thought it'll look as if I'm expecting something and can't wait to lay my hands on
it. I thought the
same. And then I thought, what am I worried about? Anybody who knows me knows that I'm not worried about what I get from Reggie. I'm not
greedy. Exactly, that's what I
thought. You can't help wondering what he left you, though, can
you? No, you can't. He didn't discuss his will with you, then?
He just said there's something set aside for a rainy day. He wouldn't do the dirty on us. Would he?
Oh, no, not Daddy.
I mean, not that I'm expecting.
Oh, no, no, quite, nor am I.
Well, I seem to be awfully early. I didn't think anybody else would be here yet.
I didn't want to get there too early. The early bird catches a cold.
Absolutely, CJ.
Not that I'm expecting anything.
Oh, no.
No.
But you can't help wondering, can you? One is human.
True. Very true.
I didn't realize you'd be here, CJ.
Yeah, well, I'm surprised. I didn't always think Reggie liked me.
Maybe he's left you something really humiliating.
God, I hadn't thought of that. Oh,
you're right.
Yes. Ticker's not too good. Nothing to worry about, though.
Oh, good. I mean, not good that it's not good. Good that it's nothing to worry. So how's the world of the estate agent, Tom?
I haven't the faintest idea.
What?
They made me redundant 3 months ago.
Don't believe it. Having me on?
I wish I was. Mr. Leeming gave me a month's notice. Told me I was too old. I said, I'm only 51. He said, really? You seem older. You don't fit our new thrusting image. These are hard times in the high street.
Arrogant, ageist bastard. Argued your case, I hope.
No. I said I couldn't work for you another day. You can stick your month's notice up your surprisingly spacious, centrally heated backside.
Yeah, rather burnt your cakes, then.
And it's the second time I've done it. My name's mud now throughout the profession.
Bit of lolly had come in handy, then.
Well, yes. Not that I'm expecting anything.
Oh, no, no. How's Linda?
I haven't the faintest idea.
What?
I haven't seen her for 7 years.
Oh, I am sorry.
I'm not. I'm delighted.
My round. A slight snag, no dosh. Cock up on the Social Security front.
Well, I'll never mind. We should be off. You could do with a legacy, then?
We all could. Not that I'm counting my chickens before they spoil the broth. Besides, I wouldn't want to benefit from Reggie's sad death.
Oh, no, absolutely not.
On the other hand, there's no point in looking a gift horse in the bush.
Absolutely not.
I didn't get where I am today looking a gift horse in the bush.
I was sorry I couldn't get to the funeral. It was our annual audit, and my boss wouldn't give me time off.
Oh, dear. Not like Reggie. He always gave you everything you wanted.
I never expected to be left anything.
Well, don't raise your hopes too high. You know Reggie's sense of humor. He might have left you his screwdrivers.
How's Tom?
Oh, I've no idea. I haven't seen him for 7 years.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, I'm not. I'm thrilled. How's work?
Oh, it isn't. I mean, that's why I can be here today. For 13 years, I satisfied Mr. McCrombie's every whim.
Sure you did.
How did he reward my faithful services? Replace me with a 22-year-old bimbo. Lovely legs, lousy typing speed. Men.
Oh! Oh, hello. Well, this is a surprise.
Certainly is. How are you, Doc?
Oh, I'm much better, thank you, Elizabeth.
Dear, have you not been well? What's been the trouble?
Oh, I haven't a clue. Some virus, I suppose. Of course, it's much easier being a doctor now than when I was practicing. Haven't a clue? Just say it's a virus. Anyway, rather foolishly, I took 6 lots of pills at once. Now I have no idea which were the ones that weren't. Do you remember when I was the Medicoat Sunshine Desserts? I kept on asking if you were chesty.
You were a naughty boy.
I still am. Having any trouble with the chest at all these days? Need a quick going over?
Well, I wouldn't come to you if I did. You wouldn't have a clue what was wrong.
No, but we could have a lot of fun finding out. Oh, I'm so sorry. No, my levity is completely misplaced. It's nerves, probably. Oh, not that I'm expecting anything.
No, nor are we.
How is Tony?
I haven't the faintest idea. I haven't seen him for 10 years.
Oh, dear, I am sorry.
Hello, everyone.
Oh, well, at least you two are still together.
Oh, yes. Togetherness is our middle name. Elizabeth, I must say that, well, we were surprised. Well, very surprised to, and we don't expect, well, anyway, I thought I'd better say that.
I'm glad you did.
Super. Sorry.
Ah, morning all, as the leather worker said to his tool. An awl is a tool used in leather making. It's used for boring.
No comment.
So I said, hello all, instead of hello all. A little play on words. Lost when you can't see the spelling, I realise that. But it's just an attempt to lighten an embarrassing atmosphere. Not that the atmosphere is embarrassing. On balance, probably a mistake all round, joke withdrawn. Morning!
CJ.
So, how are you, CJ?
Well, we're all getting older, aren't we? Except you. You're looking lovely, absolutely lovely. You're the exception that closes the stable door. Ticker's a bit dicky. Mustn't grumble, though I do.
Let's hope Reggie doesn't give you a nasty shock, then.
Quite, absolutely.
Seat next to Linda, Tom.
I'd rather stand, thank you, Jimmy.
Ah. How's young Reggie? What is he? Must be 18 now.
Yes, he left school at 15.
Ran away from home at 16.
Got a gypsy girl in trouble at 17.
Lives with her in a lay-by on the A18.
Sorry. If I'd known you were coming, CJ, I'd have brought a bottle of my passion fruit wine. I'd have valued your opinion on it.
I don't need to taste your wine to give an opinion on it.
Very kind of you to say so, CJ.
Seat here, Tom.
Oh, thank you, CJ. My legs are a little tired.
How's Mrs. CJ?
Very well. She lives in Luxembourg. I live in Virginia Water. That way our marriage works perfectly.
All hands to pump of passionate weekends type of touch. Down to it the moment the plane has landed kind of crap.
No, we never meet at all.
Sorry, I asked. Cock up on the conversation front. How's work going, David?
It isn't. I joined the family firm in Haverford West. The job wasn't particularly... well, it was a bit, but it kept the wolf from the, it was in,
Communications.
Yes. Then the firm was swallowed up by a conglomerate, and they thought I rather lacked, well, I suppose,
The ability to express yourself.
Yes. And they thought a younger man might be, well, more,
Young?
Yes.
Is this the story of our times?
No, don't tell me you've lost your job as well.
Oh, no, no. I've never even got to the stage of having a job to lose. By the time I bought up Adam and Jocasta on my own, they said I was too old even to start.
How are Adam and Jocasta?
I meant to ask, didn't dare, for fear of more bad news.
Oh, well, it's a pity you didn't ask, because they're both fine. Jocasta is touring Asia, and Adam is working for the BBC.
Neither of them bringing in any money, then. Bad.
Seems as though the lot of us could do with a bit of lolly, then. Sorry. Black mark. Bad taste. Shut up. Not that I'm expecting anything myself.
Morning.
Nine's company, ten's a crowd.
How many more people has Reggie invited? There'll be smaller shares all round.
Who's he? I've never seen him before in my life. Reggie's probably asked hundreds of people. His last great joke. Excuse me.
May I ask how you know my husband? I'm Elizabeth Perrin, by the way.
Oh, sorry. Were you speaking to me? I don't think I've met your husband, though I'm sure I should like to.
Well, I'm afraid that won't be possible. He's dead.
Oh, I'm so sorry. There's that chance gone, then.
You haven't had a letter about his will, then?
No, no, no. My name's Higgins, by the way. No, I just have an appointment with Mr. Venison.
Oh, sit down.
No, 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 thank you. When I'm tense, I just can't stand sitting. Oh. No, coincidentally, I am also here in connection with a will. I'm making my will. Oh. It's rather amusing, really. I'm leaving all my money to the Battersea Dogs Home. I just wish I could live to see the horror on the faces of my greedy, grasping relatives when they find out.
I'm sorry it's so crowded. And I really must thank you all for coming.
No, not at all. I think we were all pleased to come.
I didn't get Brian today without being pleased to come.
Before we start, may I just find out very briefly who you all are?
Elizabeth Perrin, his widow.
Linda Perrin, his daughter.
Charles Jefferson was his boss, then his employee, then his colleague, then his boss again.
Doc Morrissey, ex-medical officer, Sunshine Desserts, living in happy retirement in Southall with my ethnic friends.
David Harris-Jones, long-term employee.
Prue Harris-Jones, David's long-term adoring wife.
Joan Greengross, Reggie's secretary of long standing.
And blessedly short lying down.
Tom Patterson, ex-son-in-law, ex-estate agent, exasperated by all this drama.
Oh, Major James Anderson, Harrow, expelled. Queen's Own Berkshire Light Infantry, forcibly retired. Founder, private army, disbanded after colleague vermoosed with takings. Managing director, narrow boat, hire firm, bankrupt after another colleague vermoosed with takings. First wife, Sheila, deserted. Second wife, Lettuce, squashed by Juggernaut.
Thank you. Well, it is now my duty to read out Mr. Perrin's will to you. I, Reginald Iolanthe Perrin, being of sound mind, or as sound mind as ever I was, request Miss Hackstraw, or whoever replaces her, in the event of her predeceasing me, which I haven't, I'm glad to... Well, not glad, exactly. I certainly didn't want Mr. Perrin to predecease me, and I'm sure Mrs. Perrin didn't. Let's just say...
Abandon ship.
I beg your pardon?
Rather digging your own grave there. Sorry, inappropriate. No, all I meant was, awkward moment, thought I'd save you by tactful interruption. Awkward cove, Johnny Tapped, never quite got the hang of the blighter. Interruption over, carry on.
Thank you. Request Miss Hackstraw to read out this, my last will and testament, in the presence of those persons expressly summoned here to wit you lot. The Battersea Dogs Home is a splendid organization. But to leave one's money to it is a cliché, and I avoid clichés like a red rag to a bird in the hand, as C.J. might say.
It's true. I might. It's a failing of mine. I'm drawn to clichés like a moth to a long lane.
I would prefer to leave my money to more original causes, to form a society to provide free psychiatric help to the guilt-ridden bosses of privatized industries, to expand the legal aid system so that it can reach the needy as well as the rich, and to provide minibuses for the Lord's Taverners so that rich, privileged children can take depressed, underpaid English cricketers to the seaside. But I won't. I leave all my worldly possessions to my dear, beloved, lovely wife, Elizabeth.
Oh, hear, hear. Well, she deserves it. Good girl, big sis. And not one to desert an old soldier in difficulties.
And to her intellectually deprived, emotionally disadvantaged brother, Jimmy.
Oh, I say, I thought you'd finished. Well, don't much like the description, but have to admit, glad of the dosh.
who will no doubt need it, as there will no doubt have been a cock-up on the pensions front.
Got it in one, must be psychic.
Hardly needs to be psychic to predict that.
Tom!
You spoke to me.
Well, there's no need to be rude to Jimmy. He can't help being what he is.
Linda. Anyway, rest of you, bound to be disappointed. Bad luck. But don't worry, get into difficulties. All requests for help considered sympathetically.
And to my dear, dear daughter.
Oh, there's more. Oh, sorry, wrong end of stick.
Daughter Linda, who has supported me through thick and even thicker, and who will need all she can get after her marriage to that dreadful arse Tom.
I see. I've been brought here to be insulted. Well, I've had enough of that and I'm off.
Sit down.
What?
You have to stay. Unless everybody stays, nobody gets anything, so please sit down.
It's tempting to go anyway, but I suppose I can't, can I? Bloody hell. Bloody Reggie.
And to that dreadful arse, Tom, I love him dearly and was sorry his marriage broke up.
Oh, well, I didn't expect... Oh, well, that's very generous. I'm sorry if I was a bit ungracious.
It's not his fault he was born a dreadful arse. I'm sorry, Mr. Patterson, but I have to read it all. Those are my instructions.
That's all right, Miss Hackstall. I understand about instructions. I also was in the professions.
In the professions? Tom, you were an estate agent.
You're speaking to me again. Is this a new start?
Do you want a new start?
No.
Well, then.
Shut up! Oh. Well, I mean, I want to hear who else. I mean, if anybody else, and if so, who, has been left what? Sorry.
Darling, you were almost on the verge of being masterful for a moment there.
I was, wasn't I? Super.
Do shut up.
That's what I was telling people to do. What's the point of telling me to shut up when I'm telling people to shut up?
May I possibly continue? To Doc Morrissey, who, as he gets older, will no doubt need to buy lots of medical books to find out what's wrong with him.
Nice one. Always had a sense of humour, dear generous old Reggie.
To my dear Secretary Joan. Oh. Who had so much to put up with from me and did so much for me.
Oh, I wouldn't say that.
I would.
To CJ. I hated him once, but time is a great healer.
Absolutely. Well said, Reggie.
And last but least, to David Harris Jones and his wife, Prue. I have only one word to describe my relationship with David and Prue. Super.
Super?
To them all, I leave all my worldly goods to be divided equally.
Good Lord! Scandal! Employees getting as much as relatives. I wasn't thinking of myself. I'm thinking of Big Sis.
Thank you, Jimmy. As usual, well meant. As usual, do shut up. Dignity, Jimmy. Dignity. I think that's eminently fair, Miss Hackstraw.
Well, I think... Well, of course, we won't say no. It would be... and it is very... Very. But Prue and I getting two bites of the...
Counting David and Prue as one unit. Which is only correct, as the self-satisfied twits are always stating that togetherness is their middle name.
So that's it, then. Thank you, Miss Hackstraw. So he's divided his money among us all. Shame on those of you who thought he might have some trick up his sleeve.
The money's to be dependent on one condition being fulfilled.
Oh. Conditional, eh?
Good old Reggie. It would almost have been disappointing if there hadn't been a sting in the tail.
Silence in the ranks. All agog. Well, me agog, anyway. Sting in the tail, us all, without interruptions, please tell, Ms.
One very small condition. Each and every one of you must completely satisfy Miss Hackstraw once every 3 months until probate is completed. I'm sorry, I'm so sorry I've missed out a page. One very small condition. Each and every one of you must completely satisfy Miss Hackstraw that you have done something that is totally and utterly absurd.
That's absurd.
Precisely, Tom. He says that here. He knew you well. I know that this condition will cause you all consternation.
Absolutely. I didn't get Bram today by being absurd.
I'm just not an absurdity person.
Oh, I don't know.
Please. Reggie has many friends who could have been here today. Has it struck you why we have been chosen?
Yes. I think I know.
Oh, you do, do you? You think you have a special insight into Reggie's mind. Oh, please do tell us.
Absolutely. All agog again. Well, I'm agog again. Just as agog as I was before, possibly even agogger.
Well, I think it's because we, apart from Tony, who's gone to live in New Zealand...
Great. Sorry, I couldn't resist that. I'm sorry.
We are the people that were closest to Reggie and supported him, in his own words, through thick and even thicker, through all those projects that were closest to his heart. His rebellion at Sunshine Desserts, his grot shops, his community for the middle classes. He wants us, by being absurd, to make our individual memorials to all those absurd things we helped him to do. He wants us to prove ourselves worthy of him.
Oh, thank you, Joan. That was beautifully put. No, really, thank you.
This man walked into a bar. Arch, he cried. It was an iron bar. Joke. Old, I know, but all I could think of off the cuff, emotional tension for the relief of.
You shouldn't be frightened of emotional moments, Jimmy. They can be beautiful.
Oh, now he learns it.
Well, yes, I admit it. I've learned from my mistakes.
Oh, I see. I was one of your mistakes, was I? Terrific.
Please. I haven't finished. I know this condition will cause you consternation, but when you think about it, you will agree that it is entirely appropriate, since the money you will be receiving will have come very largely from the profits and eventual sale of my grot empire of rubbish stores, which have been wisely invested since the late 70s in the Channel Isles, the Isle of Man, Bermuda, Switzerland, Liechtenstein, in fact, almost everywhere except Lloyd's of London, who's a shrewdie then.
I didn't know he'd done all that.
I'm sorry, Elizabeth, that I never told you. I didn't want us to live on it. Life wouldn't have been a challenge anymore, and Grot was never intended to make money anyway. The decision as to whether you have been sufficiently absurd rests entirely with the beautiful Miss Hackstraw, whose cold exterior no doubt hides a seething, passionate nature. She has to read this out, although it embarrasses her, while also secretly pleasing her, because she's quite vain. Otherwise, all the money will go to the Battersea Dogs Home. By gamely reading it out, I hope she has shown you that she is not to be feared as your ultimate judge. You must contact her with progress reports and any evidence of absurdity achieved once every 3 months until probate is completed.
I just wondered, have we any idea how much money we're talking about?
Yeah.
It'd be unprofessional of me to suggest an actual figure, but at a very conservative estimate, I'd say it was unlikely to be far short of £1 million.
Oh. £1 million?
Each.
Each? What do we do?
Oh, Lorks, I've no idea. I haven't a clue. I remember. Phone for a doctor.
Go away, Doc. I want to live.
You just had a heart attack.
I haven't had a heart attack, you stupid moron. I just fainted. Large sums of money always have that effect upon me.
Been thinking. Big Sis is right. We've got to go for it. We've all got to learn to be absurd for Reggie.
We must go out there and give it everything we've got. We can't let him down. Oh, no.
Super.
And you can discover just how absurd next Sunday at 8:30. New drama in a moment on BBC One as the epic story of Cecil Rhodes continues.